coordinators and teachers of the English in the discipline course for second year science students in HKU. So in the next 15 minutes, I'm going to share with you the challenges in designing and running the course, and also the strategies that we have adopted to tackle the challenges. And then Julie will show you some sample course materials and tasks. So first of all, for challenges. So the biggest challenge we have is students' diverse language needs. Currently, we only have one English in the discipline course for all science students. And the students are from two different programs, from the actuarial science program and also the general science program. And within the general science program, you can see there are 20 major minor subjects. Some are hard science subjects, some are mathematical science subjects. So you can imagine the language needs are very different. So if we focus on lab report writing, probably the mathematical science students will complain. And if we focus on writing mathematical proof, then the hard science students will think that it's not relevant. And research report writing is probably too demanding for second year students. And academic presentation skills have been covered in the foundation course offered by the science faculty. And most of the departments in the Faculty of Science do not require students to write a lit review. So it's so difficult to think of some components which are relevant to all our students' disciplinary language needs. The second challenge we have is mixed ability students. Similar to other programs, the science faculty admits students, admits JUPAS, non-JUPAS students, and every year around 80 students graduating from the associate degree program in local community colleges also join the science program in Hong Kong U. So the students' background and language ability are very different. Some are native speakers or new native speakers, but some have rather weak English proficiency. But there's no streaming in the groupings. So some stronger students may think that the course is not useful. It's not challenging enough to them. And in general, science students have relatively low language learning motivation because they think that language learning is not important to them because their faculty doesn't emphasize that, and language learning to them it's not important at all, has a very low priority. So it's hard to motivate them in class. So in order to make the course more relevant to their disciplines, we have to make the course content a little bit more technical. It may involve some subject knowledge. But this could be a problem for language teachers because language teachers may not have the expertise and confidence to teach the course. So it's very important to strike a balance between subject content and language input. And in terms of course logistics, we have quite a large teaching team. Every semester we have around 10 teachers. These teachers, some are very experienced, but some are new teachers. And they have very different teaching styles and very different language teaching beliefs. So it's quite difficult to ensure the teaching and marking standards. And we also have quite a large cohort of students. We have 600 students per year. And this course is run in both semesters. So there are a lot of logistical issues, timetabling, course enrollment, special requests from students, many other issues, plagiarism cases. So a lot of time is needed to tackle, to handle these logistical problems. So how can we tackle the challenges? Now I'm going to talk about the strategies that we have adopted. So in terms of course design, we try to give students more flexibility and choices. There are three components in the course. For the writing component, we ask students to write a popular science article. So they can choose their own PSA topic, and the topic could be related to their major subject. What they need to do is to read academic journal articles related to the topic, and then explain the scientific technical concepts to the non-specialist audience in their PSA using different techniques, metaphor, analogy, or visuals. And for the speaking component, we develop students' spontaneous speaking skills because we think that they may go on exchange or they may need to attend job interviews. So this skill would be more relevant to all students. So in the speaking test, students need to answer one general question and one science question. And Julie will tell you more about this. And we also have a self-access language learning component. So students can identify one language area that they want to work on, and then they create their style plan and carry out the plan throughout the semester. And at the end of the semester, they reflect on their style experience. And the assessment for this component is an 8-minute oral reflection. So this slide shows you the feedback loop for the popular science article assignment. So at the beginning of the course, we introduce the PSA genre to the students. We also have students to identify their PSA topic. And in week 3, they submit their PSA topic proposal and get teacher's feedback. And from week 3 to week 7, in class, we focus on features of PSA, metaphor and analogy, structure of PSA, and skills for explaining PSA, skills for explaining science in PSA. And in the middle of the course, students submit a partial draft of their PSA, which is not assessed, but teachers give students detailed formative feedback. And in week 8 to week 9, students analyze some outstanding PSA written by students in the previous cohort, and they also obtain peer feedback on their partial draft. And in week 9, there's a writing clinic. Students meet with teachers and discuss their draft. And based on both teacher and peer feedback, they submit their final PSA at the end of the course. As mentioned earlier, students' language needs are very different. So that's why I've proposed a new ED course titled Professional and Technical Communication for Mathematical Sciences students. We are working on the materials now, and the course will be offered in September this year. And we have had a lot of meetings with the faculty just to find out more about the students' language needs. We still have the SAL component in the new course, but instead of asking students to write a PSA, we ask students to write a case analysis report. We provide a data set to students, and students need to analyze the statistical data, and then they need to write up the analysis and make recommendations based on the analysis. And they do it in groups. And after submitting the report, they do a group oral presentation. We think that these skills will be more relevant to actuarial science students, because many of them will work in insurance companies after they graduate. As for course logistics, we have a Science 4 team consisting of 4 members, including myself and Julie. We have pre-moderation meetings. We look at sample scripts, discuss the grades and comments before we have the real moderation meetings with the course teachers. And the team is also responsible for developing course materials and also revising the materials over the summer. And when I want to make changes to the course, I usually talk to the team members and then we make decisions collaboratively. And to ensure the marking standard, the assessment marking standard, Julie and I double mark around 5 to 10% of the scripts for each teacher for the PSA component and for the speaking component. And if we notice discrepancies between the grades, our grades and the teacher's grade, we usually talk to the teacher and give feedback to the teacher. And to support the new teachers on the course, I usually have casual and formal chats and meetings with the teachers just to talk about some possible ways to run in-class activities. And I also encourage teachers on the team to have a peer observation. For new teachers, I invited them to come to my class, and if they don't mind, I also observe their classes as well. And additional meetings may be needed for new teachers because I want to give them more information about the course and assessments. So these are the strategies we have adopted. And now I'm going to hand over to Julie, and she will tell you more about the materials and tasks.
Thank you very much. So now I'm going to talk about what we exactly are doing.
Okay.
First of all, let's look at the writing component. So as Ellie has mentioned, that the writing component, actually we in this course we focus mainly on the genre popular science.
All right.
And as you can see from the content page here, at the very beginning, we introduced this concept, the rationale of popular science, to students, because many of them may not know what popular science is. And then we move on to talk about the main differences between research article and popular science article, so that they know how is it different from the academic article that they are, that they usually are reading. Right. And then after that, we'll move on to really talk about the features in popular science article that they are writing on, like the use of metaphor and analogy, the overall structure, how to structure the popular science articles, and also the strategies and the techniques that they can use to explain those scientific concepts and ideas to non-specialist readers. Right. And yeah. And as you can see here, writing clinic, as mentioned by Ellie, like towards the end of the semester, before they submit the final draft, we do have like a writing clinic to let them to have a chat with us, so that they know like what the weaknesses that they have in the writing. Also, if they have any questions they would like to ask before they submit the final draft, then they can do it in the writing. So this is a sample task that I took from the writing booklet. So actually, this is this task is done in week one. All right. So in this task, actually, the purpose is to introduce the idea, the concept of popular science article to students. Because as I said before, many of them do not know what popular science article. And so we have used this website, Pop Science website. Okay, so actually this one. Okay, this is an example of popular science article from this website. And then we ask them to read this article. And then so after that, we ask them questions like, so do they understand the main ideas presented in this article? We ask them questions like, how about the structure, how the writer has structured the text, and any like, do they find any technical terms using this popular science articles? If they do, can they understand the technical terms? So these kind of general questions, so that they know the features, at least they have a very general picture of the features that they can find from a popular science article. And after that, we would ask them to go to this website to read the corresponding research article. Actually, that popular science article is based on these research article. Okay, and then we won't require them to read the whole research article, but we'll ask them to read like some excerpts from that research article, so to let them compare like now, actually, after they read that popular science article. Now we go back to look at the original academic article, and they can see the difference in terms of structure, in terms of language use, like the use of terminologies, these kind of things. Okay. So these two tasks are done in week one. Okay, so we are not like focusing on really teaching them any specific language features, but just to give them a general concept of what these popular science articles, so that they know what they are going to work on in the following weeks, and so that they know how they are going to be assessed in the writing component. And also every year, we will pick some really outstanding popular science articles to be published on this journal. HKU scientist is journal. So this is one of the examples. that can complement sales and creative cameras. Urban life skyways and all of that. So these are really outstanding authors on the article. Not just A grade, but just really we will pick some really good ones and to be published on this online journal.
We try to include a variety of topics.
Yeah. As you can see from here. Yeah. So environment, health, physics, science and society, and technology. So we include a variety of topics.
So these are student essays that you've published online?
Yeah.
Just wondering, do you let articles online without completely accurate grammar, or do you proofread them before putting them online?
We first of all get a permission from the students first, and we told them we will edit their work. So in fact, before we publish it, we edit their writing a little bit. But since these are very outstanding writing, outstanding pieces of work, so usually we don't have to change a lot. Yes.
Okay, so now let's move on to the SAL component. So the SAL, as you can see, SAL, that's language learning. So we don't really teach students how to do it. But just at the very beginning, we asked them to set their own goal, the SAL goals, okay? And then, as you can see, the SAL goals plan. This is the SAL goals plan that they need to complete, all right? So they need to know which particular area they need to work on, they want to work on, and also they really have to set a very specific goal. We always tell them that it's not enough just to think, I want to improve my speaking. Which particular part of speaking that you want to improve? Is it pronunciation or intonation or what? Okay, so so before they start the SAL, so they have to complete the SAL goals plan so that they have a rough idea of what they are going to work on. And also they need to think about what materials and methods that they are going to use in order to achieve their goals. And also they need to think about their progress as well. So there's an item here that's anticipated outcome of progress. And also they need to think about the time that they need to achieve the goals. So so they are expected to spend 15 hours on this SAL. Okay, so they can use all the 15 hours of just one goal, or we would say that at most that they can only have two goals. So another thing is about this SAL support pack. As you can see from this content page, it's a really thick booklet. It's 100-something pages. We tell students that they don't really have to read it from page 1 to page 106. So it's more like a supplementary thing. If they think that they have any questions about the SAL, or at the very beginning, as you can see, the first section is about learner profile. So they're asked to complete the questionnaires in this section here, so that in order to get to know their learning style, so that they can decide on the materials or the methods that they should be using. All right. So and then there are also sections talking about learning goals plan, and also give them recommendations and advice on materials and methods and how to manage their learning, these kind of things. Okay. So another component is speaking, spontaneous speaking. All right. So in spontaneous speaking, at the end of the course, they will have to take the spontaneous speaking test, and they will be assessed in terms of grammar, vocabulary, pronunciation, and also relevance and coherence of the speaking. So, so we do have different units in all these four different areas. So, and actually on the course Moodle, course Moodle. So we do have a list of sample responses to those science-related and general questions. As Ellie mentioned before, in this spontaneous speaking test, each student will have to answer two questions. One is science-related question, the other one is general question. And so here we have some sample response to some of these sample questions here. All right, and also up here, there are, we have transcribed three sample responses, and then in the transcript, the students can read the group features, so relating to the four speaking test assessment criteria, which can be found from these three transcripts. You mean the transcript, sample response.
Could you tell us a bit more about the spontaneous speaking exam?
We ask students two questions, one general question, one science question. Actually, the general questions are very general, as you can see from our
very general.
So it could be their experience, it could be some interview type questions, like what are your strengths and weaknesses? Or who is the most influential person in your life?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like health, this one. Health, wealth, or happiness, which is most important to you and why.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very general question. And then and for each question they do have 15 seconds thinking time. And then after 15 seconds they will have to respond to questions between 90 seconds and 2 minutes. Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So I can certainly see the rationale behind interview questions. Could you expand a little bit on the rationale of this?
Okay, actually we have the spontaneous speaking component because the science faculty told us that science students are usually good at giving academic presentations because they can prepare, they can rehearse, but then for spontaneous speaking, they usually don't have the skills. Mm-hmm. And in fact, in job interviews, they can't predict all kinds of questions that they would want. I've heard from some science students, some graduates, they told me in the interview of a government job, they need to give a spontaneous speech on just one word. They pick one word randomly, need to give a spontaneous speech on that particular word.
Right.
So I told the students, you can't predict what kind of questions you will be asked.
Right.
So we just hope that they can like organize the ideas within a very short period of time. And then we hope that they can focus more on the grammar, the pronunciation, vocabulary, and so on. So that's the reason why we have this component.
It seems that you only consult with the faculty members of science.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have any input in how the course is designed. or assessment?
Article design. What do you mean by article design?
Course design.
Oh, okay. Course design. I think they are interested in knowing more about what we are doing rather than telling us what they want us to do.
So you have full autonomy to create the course.
Yes.
If you want to make changes within a course, is that a difficult process in HKU?
Yes. We have to fill out a lot of forms and go through the teaching and learning quality committee of our center first. And then we submit the application to the faculty, to the science faculty, and the faculty board endorses it. And then it has to go up to the Senate, and there's a committee on language enhancement, which is in the language enhancement committee. So a number of levels before it can finally get approved.
So how long have you been running this course, and have you encountered any of those issues, and how did you deal with it?
Yes, this course has been run for, I think, around 5 to 6 years after the 4-year curriculum has been launched. So around 6 years. We did modify the course a little bit. In the past, we asked students to write their reflection on the sound component rather than having an oral reflection. But then the students and teachers complained that the marking load is so heavy because there's already a written assignment. And also, you know, some students, they just make their story, their learning story, in their reflection, and you can't see the learning evidence. But now we ask them to bring their learning evidence to the oral reflection. So as a teacher, we can check whether they have really done the work. Yeah, and it's more authentic when you know, see the student face to face and they tell you the learning journey. Okay. So that's the major change we have made.
And also the AE, the attitude.
Actually, we, since this year, so we scrapped the annotated bibliography assessment before that we do have this assessment. Plus, the students' feedback that they don't really think that it's useful to them because they don't need to write an AB annotated bibliography at all in their faculty. So that's why they reflect that this particular assessment is not really useful to them, relevant to them. So that's why, since this year, we have decided to scrap this one.
May I ask another question? You said that you've obviously got 2 assignments on this course, but teachers were complaining that they had too much marking. On average, how many assignments per course would a teacher have in the HKU Applied English Center, and how many courses would each teacher teach?
Actually, in this course, we have the marking load is
quite heavy.
It's heavy. We have the topic proposal, and then the half draft, and then the final draft. So 3 pieces of written work, and then the speaking test we do in class, and the oral reflection also in class. But we need to write up the comments for students as well. So
how many students in class?
20 students per group. On average, I think there are 3 to 4 assignments per course. And it depends on the workload of the teacher. If the teacher has quite a lot of admin duties, then maybe he or she doesn't have to teach so many different courses. But on average, I would say around 2 to 3.
Three courses. Twice a week.
Courses, but maybe more than 1 class for each course.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes. And for this course, we see students 3 hours per week, 2 plus 1. So the first session is 2 hours, and then the second session is 1 hour.
So 3 credits.
6 credits. We've got 6 credits, but in general, all Hong Kong
courses
are 6 courses.
I
think it's equivalent to 3 credit courses in other universities. Yeah.
Okay.